The day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation. I'm reading to you from 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter. Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Pastor Ray Greenlee from the National Prayer Chapel. We are streaming live. You're welcome to go to nationalprayerchapel.com, and there you'll find we're streaming live once more. For some time, we've not been able to stream live. The videos have been unavailable because our computer could no longer handle the necessary volume of data. A dear brother from New England has made possible for us to have a new Mac computer. I praise God for his kind heart. I said to him, I've put everything in my life for the gospel of Jesus Christ. When I see someone else take those same steps, I'm in awe. I'm very grateful when a man or a woman will step forward and say, all that I have belongs to Jesus. How can I help? So thank you, dear brother, for what you've done. I trust the computer is working today and you have that live video feed in New York where you are. I need to say some things today that may sound strange to your ears. But I urge you to stay with me through the broadcast. I urge you to cancel whatever you have to do and listen, because these words that I'm going to speak are salvation. Most of us, including myself, have been taught a gospel through the years that was not a gospel at all. And so the church today is filled with worldliness, with darkness, with sin. It's filled with entertainment. It's not sober. It's not awake. And now for many years, I've been praying and asking the Lord if he would send revival. I finally came to a place where I could no longer just pray for revival. We have defined revival as that extraordinary work of the Holy Spirit as he quickens conviction in the hearts of men and women, and they turn from their sin and they're converted. I've looked upon revival as a miracle. And so I have been praying now for many, many years, 40 years plus. I've been praying for revival. As I've thought about it, as I've prayed about it over the last 3 weeks, it's become clear to me, first, that revival is not a miracle. Revival is a natural occurrence when the conditions are met. But the conditions must be met. Over the next days, we're going to be speaking very specifically about what those conditions are from the Scripture. But let me say that it's most difficult for revival to happen in America. Now, I've read the stories of revival. I've read John Wesley, Whitfield, Finney. I've read stories of the Welsh revival of Evan Roberts. I've even spoken with pastors, very aged, who were a part of leading the Welsh revival. I've been very concerned about when does revival come to America. I have believed that God had a time when he would pour out revival, and so I have been praying and asking Jesus if he would send this work of revival in America. And it's right, revival is partly God's work. But I want to say to you today that God has already done his work for revival. It's now up to the church to meet the conditions, and then revival will be given, and the lost will be saved. Thousands can be swept into the kingdom of God in a day if we who are the church will do the proper preparation. So if revival is not a miracle, what is it? It is the natural response of God to the conditions being met. Now, it's very difficult for this to happen in America because we are very sophisticated, we're highly educated, we have learned to trust in our own strength and in our own power. But there is a second reason why it is so very difficult for godliness in America. And that is because we have a smorgasbord of options to choose from in terms of how we spend our time and energy. I was raised as a farm boy. There's not much trouble a farm boy can get into. Maybe throwing rotten tomatoes at the neighbor's cars as they pass on Halloween. And yes, I did that. Or collecting rotten eggs and taking those out and egging cars. And yes, I did that. And that was not good, but that was about the extent of the trouble I could get into as a farm boy. We didn't have television. The radio was very tightly controlled. Lowell Thomas was listened to every night, but Phil Rizzuto was turned off as junk. My parents were conservative Christian people. In the beginning of the day in the summer, we would start hoeing on one end of the field and hoe down to the other end, and their dad would have a lunch bucket for us. And then we would turn around and we'd hoe down the next row, knowing that when we got to the end of that row, we were free to go swimming for the rest of the afternoon. If we didn't get it done, there was no swimming. Believe me, in the sweltering heat, we wanted to get that hoeing done quickly, the amount apportioned us for that day, and be on our way to the river, the Shenango River, for swimming. There wasn't much we could do. You had a lot of time to think while you were hoeing out the weeds in a corn patch or a bean patch or a watermelon patch. If you were sitting on the tractor, you had a great deal of time to think. There was no iPod or iPhone or computer. There was no radio on the tractor. You sat and listened, and Dad would take the muffler off the tractor because he said, "I like to hear the tractor talk." And so we learned to listen to the tractor talk. There was time to think. And when we were finished with our swimming and we were finished with our work, a portion for the day, we came home. We had what we called supper. It wasn't dinner in those days. It was supper. We had supper, and then there was a front porch we could sit on, or there were bikes to ride. But there was time to think. And in the evening, Dad would gather the family together and he would take down the big Bible and he would read to us. He would talk with us about the gospel. And then we would have time to pray. Or perhaps sometimes Mother would read to us a classic book, a story of George Mueller and his miraculous care of the orphans, or some other mission story. And then we went to bed, and that was our day, to wake in the morning to do the same thing all over again. It was on rare occasions that we went to town, usually only for the church meetings or for grocery shopping. Once in a while, we got to town because Dad thought it was time to buy an ice cream cone for us. That's when we'd been exceptionally obedient. That was my life as a child on the farm. There was time to think. Morality was taught by my father, both by the teaching of the scriptures, by the reading of the books of stories regarding others who had walked in that way, and by the belt. That was the way I was taught godliness. There was firm discipline. But in our culture today, the firm discipline is missing. The television is substituted for the stories of missionaries. The Game Boys and all of the video games have taken the place of the scriptures. In fact, most of you, if you're honest with me, would say you don't even sit down at a family table to eat one meal a day, let alone two or three family meals a day. Everyone is going somewhere. Everyone is doing something. The children have soccer practice here or dance lessons there, or something is always going on. That makes it almost impossible for godliness to be taught in our day. And so most of you who listen to this broadcast, other than what you have heard here, most of what you have heard from preachers and from televangelists and from radio preachers even, is a desperately watered-down gospel that does not have the power to save your soul. Most is grace changers. Most pastors are grace changers. They change the grace of God into a license for immorality, telling you that you can be saved in the midst of your sin. And so there's really not much time for conviction in your life. Yesterday, after the message was given, and I'm going to share that message with you in a few minutes, after that message was given, I made an appeal and I invited people who knew they were in rebellion against God, people who knew they were sinning against God and who had a great desire in their heart to walk innocent before the Lord, to come and stand with me and let me pray for them. Many came forward with tears. But after the altar call was finished and the service was concluded, I spoke with some of those who had made a decision to come forward. And I want to tell you what they said to me. I asked them what the state of their belief was, what their feelings were like, how they were standing with Jesus. One said, "I'm not perfect. And yes, I'm still sinning. But I desire not to sin, and that's why I came forward." This person did not understand the altar appeal. They didn't understand what they stood up for. You see, the altar appeal was not if people desired not to sin. The altar call was for people who had determined in their heart that they did not want to go to hell, they wanted to go to heaven, and they were willing to stand and make a very clear statement to everyone that they renounced their sin, they cut it off, and they would no longer make any allowance to walk in it. Even though that's what I preached, even though that's what I taught them, and the altar call was very clear, they still, in their minds, thought I was talking about their desire to be with Jesus and not the firm resolve to cut off their sin and to walk clean before God. Now, part of what you're going to see as I walk with you now through the third chapter of the book of Revelation is that the decision to cut off our sin and to no longer walk in uncleanness before God, that's sexual sin, that's bitterness of heart, that's anger, snideness, sniping at one another, biting each other, stealing, lying, cheating, all forms of lust for the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the love of the world, all of these things, when walked in, mean that a person is not saved. And to be converted means to cut off all of these things by the power of the blood of Jesus. It means to no longer walk in sin. It means to walk clean before Jesus. So most people that I talk with, and I would love the opportunity to talk with you today, most people that I talk with think that a desire for God, a desire for Jesus, is sufficient. But you know what? I very much desire to make a trip to the Holy Land. I've never been to the Holy Land, and all of my life I have deeply desired the opportunity to travel to Jerusalem, to walk those ancient streets. I even know I want to stay in King David's Hotel. Now, I know it's very expensive, but because of the name, King David's Hotel, right there on the edge of the old city of Jerusalem, that's where I want to go. I want to make a trip to Jerusalem. But does that mean that I'm going to go to Jerusalem? No, it does not. My desire is intense. I want to go, but I choose to use the resources for this radio broadcast. I choose to use the resources to take care of people. I choose to use the resources God gives me to do something other than to go to Jerusalem. And so even though I desire with all of my heart to go to Jerusalem and to visit that wonderful old city where the presence of God is, I've not been able to make that trip yet. Today, you may desire Jesus with all of your heart, but if you're still walking in your sin, you're not saved. You may make a profession of faith. You may walk down the aisle as people did on Sunday because they desired Jesus. But to desire Jesus does not mean that you're going to go to Jesus and be converted and be saved. Do you see what I'm talking about? I desire very much a new car. I'm driving an old Honda Civic that's loaned to me by dear friends. I don't own a car. I deeply desire to own a car. But as I looked over how I've spent the resources that have been given to me over the past year, I see that I desired even more that people would have their mortgage paid or that this broadcast would be on the air. And so I have used the money in another way. I have not used it to buy a new car. Now, do I want a new car? Yes. Do I need a new car? Yes. Am I going to buy a new car? Not now. There are too many other needs. Some people became upset with me because they gave me some money and said, "Pastor, use this towards your new car." And instead of using it for that, I used it for the radio broadcast. I told them I did that, and they grudgingly said, "Okay, you do what you think best with it, Pastor." But you understand there is not a connection between what I desire and what I do. You may desire Jesus with all of your heart. You may desire to be saved with all of your heart. That does not mean you're saved. And it doesn't mean you have Jesus. You are not saved until you renounce your sin and cut it off. If you're walking in sin, you have a desire for Jesus, you have a desire to be saved, but that desire will not open the way for you in order for you to be saved. There has to be more. There has to be something real. You have to understand that your heart has to cut off the sin, and then you can be saved. To be converted does not mean desire. It means action. Now, I'd be happy to talk with any of you about this. My number here in the studio, and I'm here today live. I returned from a wonderful time of resting before Jesus. My phone number in studio is 877-534-0780. Eric is waiting for your phone call. He'll be happy to answer. Again, that phone number is 877-534-0780. Today, if you have more than a desire for Jesus, if you recognize that the beginning place of being a Christian is to totally leave your sin, that salvation is not progressive, let me say that again. Salvation is not progressive. Salvation is granted upon conversion. And then we grow in God's grace in maturity. It's not the cutting off of sin. That happens and we are regenerated. We are made new. We are a new creature in Christ when we cut off the sin. So let me just finalize before we go to the book of Revelation. When we speak about revival, it is not a miracle. Revival takes place when we meet the conditions, when we as individuals meet the conditions, and when the church meets the conditions. And part of the condition is that we enter into a spirit of prayer upon conversion. We'll talk more about that at a later date. Salvation is not progressive. Salvation comes to a man or a woman, a boy or a girl, when out of the desire of their heart, they make the decision that they will cut off their sin and no longer walk in it. And if you're still walking in your sin, you are not saved. You are not a Christian. You are filled with desire to become a Christian, but you are not a Christian. Now, this is a very difficult issue to wrap our hearts around, because we've been taught that we can be consumers, and we have the television, and we have the internet, and we have all the things that we fill our time with. If you desire today to have an increased desire for Jesus, and if you want today to begin to explore in your heart and your mind the cutting off of all sin, then you need to make around your life a bubble. Let me explain what I mean. I mean, you need to begin and cut off all of the places that distract your mind. Salvation comes when the mind and the heart together make a decision to give our affections to Jesus and to totally cut off everything of this world. And so if you want to have that increased conviction in your heart, you're going to have to turn the television off. You're going to have to turn off the professional sports. You're going to have to turn aside from much of the internet. You're going to have to turn away from the movies and the dance hall, the clubs and the lounges. You're going to have to turn away from worldly entertainment. You're going to have to begin to engage in things that allow you time to contemplate your condition before God. You're going to have to take a serious look at what your sin is. And I urge you to take a pencil and paper. And I urge you to write down every sin that you have committed. Every sin that you can remember committing, write it down. Then go through and write down every sin that you can think of that is a sin caused by not doing what you knew you were to do. If you have not spent time in prayer, if you have not spent time reading the scriptures, those are sins against God. They are sins of commission or omission. Omission are the sins of things you have not done. If you have not extended kindness and mercy to someone, if you have not gone out of your way to lift the burden of a brother and you were convicted that you should do so, and you have said, I'm not going to do that. If you've been convicted that you should give to the Lord Jesus and you have robbed from Jesus. If you've been convicted that you should give to this ministry and you have not, that is sin against God. Write down every sin that you have committed against the Lord, either that you have by omission or commission. You have sinned against God. Then as your mind begins to be quiet because you have turned aside from all the worldly things, begin to very carefully go over that list of sins and examine your heart before the Lord. Examine your heart and ask, are you willing to take God's side against yourself? Or do you insist on taking your side against God? I have made a vow with the Lord. And the vow that I have made is that I will take God's side against myself. I will take God's side against myself. And so I will not think that I am a victim. I will not think that what God has asked is too hard. I will not make any excuses for continuing to walk in my lust or my sin, my bitterness, my anger. I will not take a position against God and say, God, it's too hard to do what you've asked me to do. No, I will take a position on God's side against myself. And that will lead me, and it will lead you, to deep, heartbroken confession and repentance. Repentance is not just feeling sorry for what you've done. Repentance means I cut it off and I no longer walk in it because I see that I'm against God. When you sin, you are against God. We need to take a position for God against ourselves. And as we take that position, the Holy Spirit will come and begin to quicken you. Now you're going to feel very troubled. You're going to, even if you get serious, you're going to do as I've done. You will weep over your sin. You will see how you have taken your side against God and how you have denied Him, how you have rejected Him. You will see the harm you have done to others. It will break your heart. You will weep before God. You will be very troubled. That trouble, nourish it carefully. Nourish every impulse that comes from the Holy Spirit. Don't let it just drain away. Don't turn aside to some entertainment because your mind is becoming upset over your condition. The greatest problem we have, can I be very straight with you? The greatest problem you have today is refusing to come to terms with your sin. And you refuse to come to terms with your sin by when the conviction comes, when the knowledge of that sin is made clear to you, you comfort yourselves by running to the television or running to some business opportunity or running to the refrigerator and chowing down and becoming a glutton. Is it any wonder that so many people who call themselves Christians are way overweight? They're obese. I know why. because their sin causes them trouble when they listen to straight, honest preaching, and then they run to satisfy their heart's desire by eating instead of by confessing their sin. They play the part of a victim, and they say, I can't help myself. Please hear me. Jesus did everything at the cross that was necessary to absolutely set you free from your sin. He did everything necessary to set you free. There's nothing more that needs to be done except you and I have to say, yes, Lord, and turn aside from our sin. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. I've come to this radio broadcast because I believe God wants to send revival to Washington, D.C. and to the churches of this city. And so I've come to tell you out of the Word of God what the conditions are that you must meet if you are to be converted, if you are to be revived, if you are to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Some of you say, Pastor, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. No, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. You're filled with a happy spirit. You're filled with a worldly spirit. Oh, you may speak in tongues, but if you're still walking in rebellion against God, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, because He will not dwell in a man or woman who is still sinning against Him. Instead, we become like the world, and we become filled with a false spirit. And then you have the laughter, and you have the foolishness, and you have the gold flakes falling from the ceiling in some foolish revival. It's not revival at all. It's just a false spirit that's deceiving the people of God. Real revival is marked by conviction of sin, weeping, getting right with God. That's what real revival is. Now, you can go to my webpage, nationalprayerchapel.com, and we're streaming there live. You're welcome to go and either listen on the radio, or you can listen on nationalprayerchapel.com, and you can see the live video. You can also go later. We'll upload that video to our webpage, so you can watch the entirety of this broadcast if you've missed a part. The National Prayer Chapel meets at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. Let me give you that address. It's 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. You're also welcome to write to me. I would love to hear from you. Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia. Zip 22195. That address again, the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Now, you're welcome to call. I would be happy to talk and pray with you, particularly if today you are moving beyond desire and you want to renounce sin in your life and you want the victory over that sin. You want to walk clean before God. You want to be converted. You want to be saved. I'd be happy to pray with you. The number here in studio is 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. In Revelation, the third chapter, there is the last of the seven churches. Many scholars, biblical scholars, believe that these seven churches span the time of history, and that today we are in the final church. It is called the Church at Laodicea. There's much historical information I could share with you about Laodicea, but Today, that's not my intent. I want to begin walking with you through this message given by Jesus, the risen Lord. This was given after the crucifixion. This is the risen Lord as he speaks to the last day church, the church of our day. First, he's going to describe the condition of the church. And then he's going to tell us what the remedies are for that condition. And then he's going to tell us what the benefits are. I'll be dealing with this for several days this week. We begin in the third chapter, verse 14. To the angel of the church in Laodicea, write. And the word angel simply means in the Greek, messenger. Intended is probably the pastor. So this would be to the pastor of the church at Laodicea. These are the words of the Amen. And the word Amen means the final, immovable. He continues, the faithful and true witness, or the faithful and true martyr. I know your deeds, that you're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Let's go back and look at the Greek words to clearly understand what's being said. He says, I know your deeds, or I know your actions. I know what you do. I know where you go. I know what you watch. I know what you listen to. I know who you are. That you are neither cold, that is, chilled, or hot. The word literally in the Greek means to boil. I know you're neither chilled nor boiling. I wish you were one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to vomit you out of my mouth. Now, please understand, he's speaking to people who believe that they are Christians but are not. He's speaking to people who are in the church, who attend, who claim to be part of the fellowship of Christ, but they are not converted. The condition of a converted man or woman is hot, boiling. The condition of a man or woman who is unconverted is lukewarm. Thank you very much. I think I'll have a little bit of that and a little bit of this. And yes, I'll have some of that too, please. Thank you very much. And the smorgasbord we walk through, and we pick up a little of Jesus and a little of the world. We pick up a little of our business and a little bit of money here. And we go about and we collect to ourselves everything that we desire. That's the description of the American church. You remember when Jesus was speaking about the five foolish and the five wise virgins? They all had a desire to greet the bridegroom when he came. But only five of them were converted. Only five of them had the necessary oil for the journey. The other five were shut out and told, I don't recognize you. In other words, you are not saved. Remember, Jesus said at the last day, he's going to say to many, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I don't know you. And these are people who were preaching and teaching. These are people who were part of the church. And he says to them, I don't know who you are. Depart from me. And they're not allowed into the kingdom of heaven. So in other words, they are not saved. Many people that I speak with, I say to them, are you saved? And they say, yes, I'm saved. And then I say to them, are you still walking in sin before God? Oh, yes, all Christians sin. That's the false teaching. It's a lie. If you're walking in sin, you're not saved. It's that simple. There were five foolish and five wise. The foolish were not saved. Half of the church, Jesus said, will not be saved. That's sobering to me. So my question to you is, are you lukewarm? Or are you boiling hot for Jesus? Is the fondest thing of your heart Jesus? Or do you love your sin? And do you turn aside to walk in ungodliness? If you turn aside and you walk in uncleanness before God, if you walk in the lust of the flesh, the pride of the eyes, the pride of the world, you're not saved. You can make whatever profession of faith you desire. The reason Jesus came was to destroy the devil's work. This becomes abundantly clear as we walk through this passage. He said, I wish you were either one or the other, so because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to vomit you out of my mouth. So, what are you today? Are you hot or are you cold? Or are you lukewarm? Hi, Joe. Welcome. What would you like to share?
Good afternoon, Pastor. I just want you to pray for me. I lost myself.
Yes.
And I have two daughters. We used to live in Virginia Beach area, and we came up north in Maryland. And these two children dropped out from college, and they're all on drugs, you know. And I'm really confused what to do, and everything is foggy and dark, and I just need a prayer.
I'll pray for you, Joe, but I want to tell you, make sure you get right with God, and then He'll answer the cry for your children.
Amen.
Are your children's salvation worth getting right with Jesus?
Yes, they were raised and grown up in church in down in Buenos Aires.
But you understand, you can be raised in church and still go to hell.
Yes, that's true.
It means that you have to let Jesus totally remove and you cut off the sin from your own heart and begin to get red hot with Jesus for the sake of your daughters, if for no other reason.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me pray with you. Lord, my heart today goes out for my brother Joe. He's lost himself. Lord, there's a desire in his heart for you, but there are still areas of sin that have caused him to become lukewarm. That fire is no longer in his heart. And Lord, he sees his children and he sees how they're living and the drugs they're taking and the sin they're engaged in. And Lord, today you've begun again to pierce his heart with this painful, painful situation. Where if something doesn't happen, his children will be lost for eternity. And he can't stand in his heart to see that take place because he loves them.
Yes.
Lord, I'm pleading with you today. Would you do a work in Joe's heart that would move him beyond just the desire for the salvation of his children and beyond the desire for his own salvation?
Yes.
Lord, would you move him beyond that and would you begin to create such an awareness in his heart that he would renounce his sin now.
Amen. Yes.
Lord, that he would say, I am finished with this now. I'm not going to walk in rebellion against God again. I am going to take God's side against myself, and I'm going to cut this sin off now.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
Lord, I pray that right now he's making that decision in his heart.
Praise God.
Yes. And that, Lord, as he makes that decision, you will begin to deal with him and bring the joy and the love of the gospel into his heart again and ignite that fire that has been put out.
Thank you.
Lord, I don't know what the sin is. I don't know what has drawn his attention away from you. But Lord, it has to change now in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
It has to change now.
Yeah, my Lord. Yes.
Lord, I'm asking now, would you make that change? in agreement with Joe that as he says, I renounce the sin. I cut it off. That by the blood of Jesus Christ, it's washed away.
Yes, Lord.
That by the blood of Jesus, he's set free. Lord, set free to pray for his children, to begin to intercede for them, to begin to cry aloud for them.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I pray this in the name of Jesus.
Praise God.
And by the blood of Jesus.
Praise God. Praise God. Yes.
I pray in your holy name. Amen.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Pastor.
Now, Joe, I urge you, take pencil and paper and do what I've said. Write out the sins that are before you that you know you've been walking in. And take those before the Lord and one by one renounce them in the name of Jesus and cut them off.
Amen. Yes. Okay.
And get right with Jesus so that you've met the condition so that you can go into the prayer closet and you're not lost anymore. And you're not confused anymore. You're clear. And you know what you have to do for the salvation of your children. And I'll tell you right now, God loves to answer the cry of a mother or a father for their children.
Yes. Can you pray for them?
Yes, I will in just a moment, but there's one more thing I want you to do.
Amen.
Is your wife walking with you?
No, we separated like 7 years ago.
Okay, so you're single.
Yes.
I urge you to find someone and tell them the decision you've made today. And pray with them. If you have a brother that you can talk to, go talk with that brother and tell him the decision you've made and ask him to pray together with you to confirm that decision as you leave your sin. Now, Lord, I lift up the children of my dear brother Joe. Lord, they're walking in drugs. They're going to be swept away to hell if you don't intervene and save them.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, I come by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, and I claim them for the kingdom of Jesus. And I pray that whatever is necessary to happen in their hearts and in their lives will now happen to turn their hearts back to you, Jesus. I ask that you bring people into their lives who would teach them the straight gospel of Jesus.
Amen.
I ask that you will bring people who will confront them in their sin and cause them to turn aside and to seek after you, Jesus, with all their heart until you meet them.
Thank you, Jesus.
And they have renounced their sin.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
I ask this in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you, Pastor.
You're welcome, Joe. Please stay in touch with me and let me know the progress you're making, and I'll talk further with you, and I'll pray further with you.
Amen. God bless you.
That's why I'm here.
It's a comforting, yes. Yes, thank you.
Yes.
Very comforting.
God bless you.
Thank you. You too. Have a good day.
So what is your condition? You've heard what Joe's condition is. He's lost his way. But he's willing to renounce his sin. I ask you to pray for Joe as over the next days he does the work to prepare his heart to be able to pray for his children. I don't know how long it will take him. It will take him as long as it takes him to renounce the sin. Jesus is ready to meet him right now. How about you? I spoke with one brother yesterday. I said, will you make the decision now to side with God against yourself? He said, no, Pastor, I'm not ready to make that decision. I still love myself too much. He was afraid of what Jesus might do, of what Jesus might take from him if he sided with Jesus against himself. I want to tell you what Jesus will take. He'll take everything that makes you miserable. He'll take everything that is of sin and darkness. He'll take everything that will take you to hell. He'll remove it from your life and he'll bring you out into the light. and in the light he'll shed his glory upon you. He'll fill your heart with joy and with peace and with long-suffering. He'll make you a Christian. He'll make you into a new person. Now, isn't that trade-off worthwhile? What's your condition today? How do you stand with Jesus? Are you lukewarm or are you red hot? If you're lukewarm, you're lost. You may be a part of the church, you may even be a preacher. You're lost. The only way that you can be saved is to renounce your sin, to turn aside from your sin, to allow Jesus Christ to have your fondest emotions. Some people say, Pastor, what do you mean when you say give your heart to Jesus? Well, it's easy. What does it mean when a woman gives her heart to a man? Well, it means she's giving him her fondest affections. She's giving him her time, her energy. She's giving herself to him to bond together and become one. Have you done that with Jesus, or have you done that with the world? Are you one with your television and your Game Boy and your video games? Are you one with your professional sports? Are you one with Jesus, or are you one with the world? I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel. We have just a moment left in this broadcast. Let me pray for you. Lord, I pray today that every person that I've spoken to with such bluntness and such clarity will make a decision now to renounce their sin, that they will make a decision now to be converted and to turn to you, Jesus, and that they will no longer create any hiding places. Lord, I ask your blessing on each person as they make this decision. Strengthen them by your Spirit to make this decision. By the power of your blood, I plead for their salvation and for revival. In the name of Jesus, amen. God bless you. I'll talk with you soon.
Before the presence of his glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of